Hello everyone, and welcome once again to Let's Play Skyrim. Last time when we left off, I was wrapping up the Dawnguard Radiant quests. That is, in fact, still what we're up to. We're currently on a rescue mission from our buddy Florentius. We're back at Gallows Rock once again, here to save Fastrid, who we met during the Book of Love quest back in Iverstead. This is all Radiant, of course. It could be any dungeon, any NPC you're friends with. I'm tempted to try and skip as much as I can. And I don't think it's going to be too bad. Looks like Fastrid's going to be in one of the jail cells. Completed. Kill the master vampire. Rescue Fastrid from Gallows Rock. Now that's weird. What killed the master vampire, I wonder? Don't know. Don't care. If I don't have to go through the whole dungeon, then I'm not going to.
You came for me. How did you know?
Return to Florentius Banius. Yes, let's do that. Maybe the Master Vampire wasn't coded correctly, and he ran afoul of the Silver Hand. That'd be kind of funny. Anyway, whatever the case, we're ready to head back to Fort Dawnguard. Ah, yes. Enemies nearby. Shadowmere, I just wish that every so often you'd get on board with the whole don't engage, escape paradigm. It's all good, though. We're out of here now. For real this time. Back to Fort Dawnguard. I'd love it if Florentius would give me a Lost Relic quest, but we're probably going to have to do a few for Gunmar. Since we're about to push forward into the Dragonborn expansion in earnest, I will mention that what that last loading screen tooltip said is actually pretty important. The various armors added by Dragonborn are tied into existing smithing perks.
I knew you had it in you. RK's been watching over me. I know. RK told me of your success. Look, I'll be honest with you. I have no idea. But I'm sure we can find something.
What can I do to help?
Oh, well.
Oh, come on.
Things, I suppose. Remedies, cures, a poison or two. I once killed 30 vats. Speak with Gunmar. He has something for you.
Congratulations, friend. You've won. Cozy little place, isn't it? I found that he's holed up with him. We need to destroy him before he turns his comrades into a brood of vampires.
Crossroads Watchtower. Oh, good. That's going to be easy. It's just one necromancer and one vampire. Anyway, they tie into existing smithing perks. So you can make bone mold armor with steel smithing. You can make chitin armor with elven smithing. You can make Nordic armor with, I think it's advanced armors. And you can make Stalrim armor with ebony smithing. There's an achievement for crafting an item out of Stalrim, so we'll want to make at least one before the game ends. Boy, Falkreath Watchtower is Crossroads Watchtower. Is he fighting the Necromancer, or did my horse aggro him? Awesome. Return to Gunmar. Sure, we should search the Necromancer though, because they do occasionally drop spell tomes, which I do still need. Alas, no such luck here, but that's fine. There's still enemies nearby, are you friggin' kidding me? A dragon, apparently. Whatever, we're out! Alrighty. Let's turn this one in.
Cozy little, isn't this?
Rather than leave all this shit on the ground, clogging up the cell, expanding our load times, should probably just pick it up and sell it. All of it.
RK's been watching over me for years now. He says he's not too sure about you yet, though.
There we go. That's close to everything I had dropped on the ground that was still sitting here.
Our sense of what's right. Excellent. That's... keep yourself armed and protected as best you can.
Well, of course. Keep the Dawnguard rune hammer, obviously. And we're holding on to those 7 scathe craw.
Good luck.
Where is my man Florentius? Right here. Good.
Don't you worry about me. I've been speak with Gunmar. He has something for you.
Damn.
We'll speak again soon.
Fine. I'll do another Gunmar quest.
Don't give up. I've learned about you, and while I do not know, pay a visit to the beast last known contact. Then root out the monster and destroy it.
Okay.
You're getting along with Isran. He takes some getting used to.
Go to Morthal and talk with Thonir. That's kind of a silly Radiant choice, considering Thonir is like the one NPC who probably would never forgive vampires ever, based on his unfortunate role in the Laid to Rest quest. Ah well. We'll get it, one way or another. Let's go chat with Thonir.
getting any trouble. What can I do for you, friend?
May the gods watch over...
I don't know what... That letter's the last I've heard.
Cragwallow Slope. Okay, well, we've read that already. Off to Cragwallow Slope, which is this one with all the Atronox, if I remember right. Yes. I love it when all my perks synergize correctly and I actually manage to sneak through a dungeon like a uber ninja of doom. Looks like we're gonna have to go all the way through this one. Which I suppose will give us the opportunity to search the boss chest, so I shouldn't be too grumpy about it. Might as well nick this chest too while we're here. Bagged him. That was awesome. Oh, I forget these mage dungeons can have Atronach Forge recipes, too. Unfortunately, as handy as that would be, we did not get one here. Oh well. So it goes. Just because I know there's a chest stuck back here. Alright. Enough of that. Come on now, Florentius. Send me after one of the other two Dawnguard artifacts. I'm so ready to be done. I was thinking to myself, now that Serana's human, since Valerica won't turn you, as far as I know, yeah, she won't turn you, I've actually cut off all avenues of becoming a vampire lord again. Couldn't do it even if I wanted to. Sup, bro?
For now, but we can't stay for those who... Our compassion compels us to destroy it. What do you need? Blades?
What did he give me?
Smithing materials?
wasn't paying attention, didn't see what it was. Hide bracers of lockpicking, apparently. Varantius? You're the only one I want to talk to, dude. You're gonna send me to Gunmar again, aren't you?
I've been poring over some
yes!
left here in the keep. Interesting stories indeed. Seems the previous incarnation of the Dawnguard had, at one time, some interest. Arkay and I think it could be a great advantage for
started. Lost relic. Retrieve the Dawnguard rune shield from Bloodlet Throne. What is this artifact?
A magical shield that, when blocked with, surrounds its wielder with a holy aura that harms the undead. Might come in handy.
Any idea what I'll be up against?
What's that, Lord? Well, should I tell him? Vampires, perhaps. Nothing you can't handle.
Understood.
Go with the light.
All right. Clarentius Banius has sent me to retrieve the Dawnguard rune shield from Bloodlet Throne. That'll be 2 out of 3. Bloodlet Throne is the vampire-infested military fort down in Falkreathhold, if you remember. Let's head down there now. There it is. In we go. I know some of these gargoyles are live, but I don't actually care if I don't have to fight them. Let's just move along. Keep on, keep it on! Quickness is the watchword. Why? As I'm more interested in the Dragonborn expansion. Feeding my hunger for nostalgia and a nice thematic bridge into my Morrowind let's play. Just these few little chores to take care of first, then we'll be done. No one's here. Wherever would you get the idea that someone was here? Well, that's a shitload of vampires. Who the hell is still active? Oh, the trapped wolf in here, I'm sure. Oh, I can't kill it through the cage? That seems silly. Thought for sure you could shoot through the cage wall. Shows what I know. Good night. I knew I remembered a chest in there. Oh, there's one here too. Still, I love killing things quickly and sneakily enough that it doesn't even cue up the combat music track. That's awesome. Do you know what is weirdly exciting to me? At E3 this year, somebody asked Todd Howard about Elder Scrolls 6. And he said, well, of course they're gonna make it. Which some people misconstrued to mean it was currently in development. He later clarified, said, no, Elder Scrolls 6 is not currently in development. Instead of Elder Scrolls 6, my understanding is that we're going to see not one, but two new IPs from Bethesda before they work on in earnest on Elder Scrolls 6. And I am crazy excited about that, because I was looking into Bethesda's history, and I'm pretty sure that Bethesda Game Studios, Bethesda Softworks, last original IP was in fact the Elder Scrolls. Bethesda Game Studios was doing, what am I doing? I need the Dawnguard Rune Shield. Completed. Retrieve the Dawnguard Rune Shield from Bloodlet Throne. Return to Florentius Banius. So we can take that one off of our unique item list. Always good. Outstanding work. Let's see if there's anything else in here we want. A little bit, sure. Anyway, I was looking into it, and I'm not sure what else Bethesda Softworks did pre-Morrowind, but I do know, I mean, obviously, there was Arena and Daggerfall. As a separate entity from Bethesda the publisher, Bethesda Game Studios' first game was Morrowind, and then they did Oblivion, and then they did Fallout 3, and then they did Skyrim, and then they did Fallout 4. You may be noticing a theme here, no original IPs, because, I mean, obviously Fallout 3 came from Interplay, so the fact that they're actually doing something new. And obviously, newness is always a huge risk. It could be something awful that crashes and burns, but I actually find it really exciting. New IP in this day and age is a rarity, and I always celebrate it when someone has the balls to try it. Anyway, let's wrap this quest up.
Well done. I said you'd return victorious. RK wasn't so sure. Wield it bravely.
All right. We've completed our second instance of Lost Relic now. Only one more to go. Let's get after it.
Speak with Gunmar.
Of course he does. Speak with Gunmar for an assignment. Will do. After I sell you that, that necklace.
Things, I suppose. Remedies, cures, poison or two.
I'll hold on to the rune shield, of course.
Cozy little place, isn't it? I've located, track him down, tread lightly. The law is unaware of the danger. The light be with you.
Discreetly kill traveling pilgrim in Markarth. Alright, can do that. Let's roll. Whee! Whoa. No, I want to go to the actual city of Markarth, and I don't want you to be scrolling. There you go. Yikes. Oh, good.
My favorite drink.
He's in here, like an idiot. I love it.
Come on, you trying to hide? I have plenty of strong drink and clean rooms.
Somebody help!
It's easy to be discreet when you can just hide from everybody. Oh, what a pain in the ass. Guess we'll have to do a two-step. We'll go to Blackbriar Lodge first. And for Dawnguard, there we go. And Florentius will probably give us another rescue mission before he gives us the last artifact quest. That's just how it goes.
This is fine for now, but Eric, though there's plenty more of it, keep yourself armed and protected as best you can.
I once killed I've been pouring over.
Yes! Oh, that was easy.
It seems the previous incarnation, Arkay and I think it could be a great advantage.
Started. Lost relic. Hey, this is it. That only took like half an hour. That's awesome. Retrieve the Dawnguard Rune Axe. I forgot where it was. What is this artifact?
An axe imbued with magic, fueled by the destruction of the unholy. With every victorious blow against an undead creature, its power grows. Arkay warns its baneful charge abates with each dawn. Something to keep in mind, I suppose.
Any idea what I'll be up against?
What's that, Lord? Well, should I tell him? Arkay says bandits. Oh, wait. No, he says bandits. Nothing you can't handle.
Understood.
Go with the light.
Wow, that was awesome. I guess it is random. Florentius Banius has sent me to retrieve the Dawnguard Rune Axe from Lost Knife Hideout. Oh, good. Lost Knife is a big one. But hey, this... Yes, this is, in fact... Are you ready for this? The final Radiant quest we're going to have to do in mainland Skyrim. We have done all of the others. How cool is that? Now, there will be some on Solstheim, too, but Solstheim's a lot smaller, and it's a lot less repetitive, and it's packed with nostalgia for Morrowind, so... This is fantastic. Oh, how exciting. Screw you, buddy. I'm not your friend, buddy. I'm not your buddy, guy. Yeah, that's about what I thought. No shortcut through here, unfortunately. That's right. Of the big, crowded bandit dens, this is certainly probably the coolest, just in terms of the way it's designed. Oh, for... That was a bunch of bollocks. Oh, this is exciting. I think I'll skip back there. What the hell? There we go. Oh, I'm just really excited that it gave me the third quest that fast. I haven't been that lucky in ages. And now I don't even care! Because that was the last Radiant quest! In the base game.
Anybody there?
Gotta keep on specifying that. Just for clarity's sake. But even that's exciting. Now even some of the Radiant quests on Solstheim can actually send you to dungeons back on the mainland too, just like the inverse, but still. There aren't very many. In fact, I think the only real Radiant quests come from Neloth at Tel Mithrin, so... it's not anything you need to worry too much about. Let's do this. Come on, mofos. Yeah, I see ya. Oh, sucks to be you. Oh, you too. Oh, that was right in your grill. Oh my gosh, how awful for you. Y'all done got fucked up. That was awesome. Oh, of course, there's still a couple more bandits on the way out, but here is the Dawnguard Rune Axe. Completed. Retrieve the Dawnguard Rune Axe from Lost Knife Hideout. Return to Florentius Banius. So there is the final unique item from Dawnguard. Every other unique item left to find is part of the Dragonborn expansion. Cool. See if there's anything else in here that I want. Nope. Cool. Let's, I should probably eyeball what it actually does. Enchantment does additional sun damage based on the number of undead killed, 0 undead killed, and the shield, plus 10 bash damage against vampires, and sustained blocking creates a minor sun shield doing 10 points of damage while draining the wielder's stamina. Those are some actually pretty cool items for the aspiring vampire hunter. Let's make what I surmise should be our very last trip to Fort Dawnguard to complete this quest. And we'll make a quick trip to Windstad Manor to drop off the Dawnguard artifacts, pick up everything that we had hoarded in advance that we're going to need in Solstheim, and then we'll head back there and hopefully just commit to staying on Solstheim for a good long while. Oh, good. You can just skip the other bandits. Why not? Works for me. Alrighty. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Out we go. Fort Dawnguard. There we go. All right. Here is Florentius.
Arkay's been watching over me for years.
I've retrieved the Dawnguard Rune Axe from Lost Knife Hideout.
Well done. I said you'd return victorious. Arkay wasn't so sure. Wield it bravely.
Do not, under any circumstances, ask what you can do to help. Unless you want to do more Dawnguard quests. Because you crazy.
Look, I'll be honest with you. I have no idea.
Instead, we'll just sell him back that armor. Now, the final instance of Lost Relic is complete. I'll take it off the quest list. How awesome is that? Oh, I'll tell you. So awesome! Bye-bye, Dawnguard. See you when I see you. Alright, let's head to Winstead right quick.
The gold is flowing nicely. Here's your half of the profits, my dear.
Let's play a game.
This is the last time we're going to be home for a while.
Okay, you stand right there and count to 10. No peeking. Red.
So first things first. All this, so I don't know why I have two Briar Hearts. I also don't know why I have the Witch Heads. There's a lot I don't actually need anymore, but I'll deal with that as I come to it. Let's head in here. Let's drop the Dawnguard artifacts off with all of our other cool, unique gear. Just wander over here right quick, because I don't need a second Briar Heart. The rest of this I do need. The Glenmoral Witch Heads I do not need. Let's drop those in here. A holdover of a prior quest line. Those 15 ebony ingots I need. Black Star, obviously. The attunement sphere we still can't get rid of. All of this we need. And other than that, we're good. Let's check the girl's dresser. Potion, apples, hawk feathers. Alright, easy enough. Potion. Apples, hawk feathers. There we go. And we're out. Let's head back to Solstheim. Which is easy enough to do. There's a ton going on. Right here in the town of Raven Rock, which is where we'll wind up when we fast travel back to Solstheim. Alright, now there's some cool stuff to show you too. Let's start out just by poking around out here, looking to see if there's anything useful here in or around the docks. Note these neat looking urns. Ash yams restore 1 point of health. So they're much less valuable than they were in Morrowind, where they were an alchemy ingredient with a fortify intelligence effect. So it goes. We have trauma roots here, and I think I actually still need to harvest one of those, because I don't know all the effects yet. So, we'll eat one, and we'll discover Damage Magicka and Slow, which will allow us to take trauma root off of the alchemy ingredient list. Pretty cool. Let's look around. What do we have here? Inside the town, we have... These are veteran guards. We have the Bulwark. Another mouth to feed. And the Bulwark Jail.
Keep moving.
We have... The Ulan Ancestral Tomb. Kaerelius House. This is what I was trying to get to. A few more urns. I'm back to fully searching because I haven't actually been to any of these places yet. Up here we got more urns that bear a striking resemblance to the urns we actually saw in Morrowind. Super cool. Another veteran guard. Here's the temple. Note the soundtrack. Note the ash all over the ground. You'll see why in just a moment. Let's head up to this southern wall. See that plume of smoke over there? Well, what do you suppose that is? Why, that's the Red Mountain at the center of Vardenfell. Still erupting, constantly, I think, as a result of the Red Year, and the source of all this... presumably responsible for all the ash that now covers the south end of Solstheim. But anyway, there's where we spent all of Morrowind, Vardenfell Island, right over there. Let's check on these. All right. You know me, I like to explore the rest of the town exterior first. Let's duck down here, see what we got here. The Morvane Ancestral Tomb has an expert lock on it. That's a little intriguing. Here's the... There's Morvane Manor. Here, I'll explore the rest of the docks, I suppose, before I get to the rest of the town. Not that there's really anything to find out here, but we'll check it out anyway. Well, even just the music takes you on a nostalgia trip. That's the Earthstone. It was mentioned we should look over there for answers regarding the, Yeah, pearl oysters will actually give you pearls, which is kind of cool. Here is, you can get ashen grass pods from the spiky grass clusters here, which have their own set of effects. Resist fire, fortify lock picking. So, with that, I can take those off of my alchemy ingredient list. That's just a trauma root. We'll get over there later. Instead, let's pinch in and check out the rest of the town. You can see some old hollowed out things that presumably used to be buildings. Aren't anymore, obviously. Another veteran guard. Yes, yes, yes. Now what is this? This is Severin Manor. Okay. It's hard to tell the difference between a trauma root and an ash creep cluster. Because that is another thing that exists that you can find. There's the abandoned building.
Here's... You haven't seen Corellius, have you? That foolish old man's taken my pickaxe again.
Glover Mallory, Milor Ianeth.
Looking for any potions? Ingredients?
Or Ianth. Milor Ianth, Ianth Farm, Garen Ianth.
Rock traveler, could I interest you in any fine ash-grown foods?
Okay. What do we have up here? A smelter, chopping block, and the Ravenrock Mine. Anyone who's played Blood Moon will certainly remember that. What else do we have out here? Ash yams, sure, that's fine. Okay, okay. Here is Fethys Alor with a bunch of Sujama. The Alor House with an apprentice lock. Few more urns. And that's pretty much it for the town. So the first place I really want to explore is the Bulwark. It's the guard barracks. So let's head in there first. Ultimately, a guy named Captain Veleth will show up in here, but he starts outside. The only other person in here are the generic veteran guards. However, there is a note to read, a posted notice, which I'll read and remove from my book list. This is a reminder that Emberbrand wine and other such contraband is off limits to all of you. Any guardsmen caught with items like this in their possession will be disciplined and subject to possible removal from the Redoran Guard. Captain Veleth. Alrighty. Neat, neat. What else we got? The House of Troubles. That's a new book. Although it appeared in Morrowind, it's added to Skyrim by the Dragonborn expansion, so let's read it and take it off the list. The House of Troubles. Among the ancient ancestral spirits who accompanied St. Veloth and the Chimer into the promised land of Morrowind, the four Daedra lords, Malakath, Mehrunes Dagon, Molag Bal, and Sheogorath, are known as the Four Corners of the House of Troubles. These Daedra lords rebelled against the council and admonition of the tribunal, causing great kin strife and confusion among the clans and great houses. Malakath, Mehrunes Dagon, Molag Bal, and Sheogorath are holy in that they serve the role of obstacles during the testing. Through time, they have sometimes become associated with local enemies like the Nords, Akaviri, or Mountain Orcs. Malakath is the reanimated dung that was Trinimac. Malakath is a weak but vengeful god. The Dark Elves say he is Malak, the God King of the Orcs. He tests the Dunmer for physical weakness. Molag Bal is, in Morrowind, the King of Rape. He tries to upset the bloodlines of houses and otherwise ruin the Dunmer gene pool. A race of monsters said to live in Molag Amur are the result of his seduction of Vivek during the previous era. Sheogorath is the King of Madness. He always tests the Dunmer for mental weakness. In many legends, he is called upon by one Dunmer faction against another. In half of these stories, he does not betray those who called him, further confusing the issue of his place in the scheme of things. Can he help us? Is he not an obstacle? He is often associated with the fear other races have of the Dunmer, especially those who, like the Empire, might prove as useful allies. Mehrunes Dagon is the god of destruction. He is associated with natural dangers like fire, earthquakes, and floods. To some, he represents the inhospitable land of Morrowind. He tests the Dunmer will to survive and persevere. The worship of these four malevolent spirits is against the law and practice of the temple. However, the Four Corners seldom fail to discover those greedy, reckless, or mad enough to serve them. By ancient temple law and custom, and also by imperial law, the lives of witches and warlocks are forfeit, and imperial garrisons join ordinators and buoyant armagers of the temple in tracking down and destroying these foul covens in the wilderness refuges and ancient ruins where they conceal their profane worships. There you go. Cool. Further in, yeah, empty evidence chest. That kind of gives you a clue what this is and where it is. Here is the Red Year Volume 1. That's a new book we'll need to take off the list. The The Red Year, Volume 1, by Melis Ravel. Foreword. When I originally decided to write this accounting of the Red Year, I elected to travel across Morrowind and speak to the Dunmer people themselves. I sought first-hand accounts and personal views about the cataclysmic event. I felt that if I simply did the research in the library stacks at the College of Winterhold, I wasn't really telling the tale that needed to be told. What struck me as I moved from city to city, town to town, camp to camp, is that all of the Dunmer I met shared an incredible bond of sheer courage and unshakable faith. So what began as a chronicle of one of the worst events in the history of Morrowind became something altogether different, the celebration of a people who can never be defeated. Dralin Vess, Tyr. The ground, it just turned into mush. There was almost no warning. I mean, we were what, perhaps a mile from the nearest swamps? It was like the swamp suddenly swallowed up half of the city. I asked him to describe what happened from the beginning. I owned a farm just outside of Tyr at the time. We were planting the next season's crops and getting ready to store what we had harvested. Everything was going well until the Red Mountain exploded. Almost immediately, the ground rumbled and shook. Cracks started forming everywhere, and then the water just started seeping through. It was awful. In a matter of hours, I was knee-deep in swamp water, running for my life. Where I was running, I had no idea. At first, I ran towards the city itself, but it looked like the walls were cracking. All around me, people were desperately trying to save their livestock and their families from the rising water. Just when the ground shaking finally died down and I had a moment to think, there was a horrible cracking noise. I'll never forget it because I knew what it was before I looked. The entire southern wall of Tyr collapsed, sending guards tumbling into the swamp. I heard people screaming as they were covered by the rubble and forced down into the water. Forgetting my own problems, I looked over at my fellow farmers who were all staring at the carnage unfolding before us. Suddenly, we all just forgot our own problems and ran to help. There must have been hundreds of the poorer folks who lived outside the walls, helping the richer ones who lived in the city. Never saw anything like that. I think we must have saved hundreds more that day. Neria Relithil, Nissus. Neria was badly burned by the eruption and had trouble speaking to me. She is currently convalescing at the Temple of Azura in Blacklight, even after all these years. I've tried to record her story to the best of my ability. It was such a terrible thing, the fire. It burned everything in its path. It flattened trees, turned our huts into splinters, and knocked over towers like they were made from parchment. It all happened in an instant. A rumbling sound, then a massive wall of flame. It was so high it blocked out the sun. I thought that the world itself had split apart. It passed over the water and turned it to steam, vaporized everything it touched. When it finally hit us, I was blown off of my feet. Didn't even have time to run away or seek shelter. I ended up in the riverbed next to town, which kept some of the flames off of me. All around could smell the charred stench of death. There were Dunmer that were burned alive, and some never even saw it coming. I lay in that riverbed for 2 days before the healers found me. When I could finally stand, Nissus was gone. There wasn't a thing left. It's as though it was wiped from the face of Tamriel. We have Bone, Part 1. Another book that made an appearance in Morrowind that we now, that the expansion added to Skyrim. We'll take it off the list and read it. Bone, Part 1, by Tavi Dromio. It seems to me, said Garaz, thoughtfully looking into the depths of his flin, that all great ideas come from pure happenstance. Take, for instance, the story I told you last night about my cousin. If he hadn't fallen off that horse, he never would have become one of the Empire's foremost alchemists. It was late one Midas night at the King's Ham, and the regulars were always especially inclined toward philosophy. I disagree, replied Jomara, firmly but politely. Great ideas and inventions are most often formed slowly, over time, by diligence and hard work. If you'll recall my tale from last month, the young lady, who I assure you is based on a real person, only recognized her one true love after she had slept with practically everyone in North Point. I put it to you that neither is the case, said Hallgard, pouring a topper on his mug of grief. The greatest inventions are created by extraordinary need. Must I remind you of the story I told some time ago about Arslakone and the invention of bone mold? The problem with your theory is that your example is entirely fictional, sniffed Shomara. I don't believe I remember the story of Arslakone and the invention of bone mold, frowned Garaz. Are you sure you told us? Well, this happened many, many, many years ago, when Vardenfell was a beauteous green land, when Dunmer-Werkheimer and Dwemer and Nord lived together in relative peace when they weren't trying to kill one another, Holgerd relaxed in his chair, warming to his theme. When the sun and moons all hung in the sky together, Lord, Mother, and Wizard, grumbled Jomara, if I'm going to be forced to hear your ridiculous story again, pray don't embellish and make it any longer than it has to be. This all happened in Vardenfell quite some time ago, said Holgerd, ignoring Jomara's interruption with admirable restraint. During an era of a king you would never have heard of, Arslak Own was one of this king's nobles and very, very disagreeable fellow. Because of his allegiance to the crown, the king had felt the need to grant him a castle and land, but he didn't necessarily want him as a neighbor, so the land he granted was far from civilization, right in an area of Vardenfell that is even today not quite civilized to this day. Arslak Own built a walled stronghold and settled down with his unhappy slaves to enjoy a quiet if somewhat grim life. It was not long before his stronghold's integrity was tested. A tribe of cannibalistic Nords had been living in the valley for some time, mostly dining on one another, but occasionally foraging what they liked to call dark meat, the Dunmer. Jomara laughed with appreciation. Marvelous! I don't remember that from before. It's funny how you don't hear much about the Nords' rampant cannibalism these days. This was obviously, as I've said, quite some time ago, said Holgerd, glaring at part of his audience with civil malevolence, and things were in many ways quite different. These cannibalistic Nords began attacking Arslak Own's slaves in the fields, and then slowly grew bolder, until they held the very stronghold itself under siege. They were quite a fearsome sight, you can imagine. A horde of wild-eyed men and women with dagger-like teeth filed to tear flesh, wielding massive clubs cloaked only in the skins of their victims. Arslak Own assumed that if he ignored them, they'd go away. Unfortunately, the first thing that the Nords did was to poison the stream that carried water into the walled stronghold. All the livestock and most of the slaves died very quickly before this was discovered. There was no hope of rescue, at least for several months, when the king's emissaries would come reluctantly to visit the disagreeable vassal. The next closest source of water was on the other side of the hill, so Arslak Own sent three of his slaves with empty jugs to bring some back. They were beaten with clubs and eaten before they were a few feet outside the stronghold gates. The next group he sent through, he gave sticks to defend themselves. They made it a few feet farther, but were also overwhelmed, beaten, and devoured. It was obvious that better personal defensive was required. Arslak Own went to talk to his armorer, one of his few slaves with specific talents and duties. The slaves need armor if they're going to make it to the river and back, he said. Collect every scrap of steel and iron you can find, every hinge, knife, ring, cup, everything that isn't needed to keep the walls sturdy, smelt it, and give me the most and the best armor you can, very, very quickly. The armorer, whose name was Gorkith, was used to Arslak Own's demands and knew that there could be no compromise on the quality and quantity of the armor or the speed at which he worked. He labored for 30 hours without a break, and recall without any water to slake his thirst as he struggled with the kiln and anvil, until finally he had 6 suits of mixed metal armor. 6 slaves were chosen, clad in the armor, and sent with jars to collect river water. At first, the mission progressed well. The Nord attacked the armored slaves with their clubs, but they continued their march forward, warding off the blows. Gradually, however, the slaves seemed to be walking uncertainly, dazed by the endless barrage. Eventually, one by one, they fell, the armor was peeled from their bodies, and they were eaten. The slaves couldn't move quickly enough in that heavy armor you made, said Arslak Own to Gorkith. I need you to collect all the cadavers of the poisoned livestock, strip their skin, and give me the most and the best leather armor you can, very, very quickly. Gorkith did as he was told, though it was a particularly repulsive task, given the rancid state of the livestock. Normally it takes quite a time to treat and cure leather, so I understand, but Gorkith worked at it tirelessly, and in a half a day he had 12 suits of leather armor. 12 slaves were chosen, clad in the armor, and sent with jars to collect river water. They progressed at first much better than the earlier expedition. 2 fell almost immediately, but the others had some luck outmaneuvering their assailants while deflecting an occasional blow of the club. 7 got to the river, 3 were able to fill up their jars, and 1 very nearly made it back to the stronghold gates. Alas, he fell and was eaten. The Nords possessed a remarkably healthy appetite. What we need before I completely run out of slaves, said Arslak Own thoughtfully to Gorkith, is an armor sturdier than leather but lighter than metal. The armorer had already considered that and taken stock of the materials available. He had thought about doing something with stone or wood, but there were practical problems with demolishing more of the stronghold. The next most prevalent stuff present in the stronghold was skinned dead bodies, hunks of muscle, fat, blood, and bone. For 6 hours, he toiled relentlessly until he produced 18 suits of bone mold, the first ones ever created. Arslacone was somewhat dubious at the sight and smell, but he was very thirsty, and willing to sacrifice another 18 slaves if necessary. "Might I suggest," Gorkliff queried tremulously, "having the slaves practice moving about in the armor here in the courtyard before sending them to face the Nords?" Arslacone coolly allowed it, and for a few hours the slaves wandered about the stronghold courtyard in their suits of bone mold. They grew used to the give of the joints, the rigidity of the backplate, the weight pushed onto their shoulders and hips. They discovered how to plant their feet slightly askew to keep their balance steady, how to quickly turn, pivoting without falling down, how to break into a run and stop quickly. By the time they were sent out of the castle gates, they were easily, very nearly, almost amateurs in the use of their medium-weight armor. 17 of them were killed and eaten, but one made it back with a jar of water. "It's perfect nonsense," said Jomara, "but my point is still valid even so. Like all great inventors, even in fiction, the armorer worked diligently to create the bone mold. I think there was a good deal of happenstance as well," frowned Garaz, "but it is an appalling story. I wish you hadn't told me." "If you think that's appalling," grinned Hallgard, "you should hear what happened next." And we get to, right now in Bone Part 2 by Tavi Dromio, which I will remove from the book list. "What do you mean the story gets more appalling?" Garaz was incredulous. "How in Boethia's name could it get more appalling?" "It's a ruse," Shomara scoffed, ordering two more mugs of grief and a glass of Flynn for Garaz. "How much worse can a tale get which prominently features cannibalism, abuse of slaves, and the regular placement of rotting animal carcasses?" "Don't you dare me," growled Hallgard, annoyed by his listener's lack of appreciation of his prose styling. "Remind me where we were." "Arslacone is the owner of a stronghold under siege by savage cannibalistic Nords," said Jomara, keeping a straight face. "After a lot of deaths and several unsuccessful attempts to get water, he had his armorer with the unlikely name of Gorkith outfit his slaves with the first ever bone mold armor. One of them finally makes it back with some water." "It was only one jar full of water," said Hallgard, pulling back in his chair and continuing the tale. "And Arslacone drank most of it, passing the remains to his dear armorer Gorkith, and the last dribbles to the few dozen slaves who still lived. It was hardly enough to sustain health and well-being. Another expedition was necessary, but they had only one suit of bone mold left, as there was only one survivor of the trip. One out of 18 slaves made it through the gauntlet of Nords wearing that marvelous bone mold armor of yours," said Arslacone to Gorkith, "and one can only carry back enough water for one. Therefore, mathematically, as we have, counting you and me, 56 remaining people at the stronghold, we need armor for 54. Since we already have one, you only need to make 53 to make the total. That way, three will make it back, with enough water for you and me and whoever's in the best condition to partake. I don't know what we'll do after that, but if we wait, we won't have enough slaves to fetch even a couple days' worth of water." "I understand," whimpered Gorkith, "but how am I going to make the armor? I used all the livestock bones to make the first batch of bone mold." Arslacone gave an order which Gorkith fearfully complied with. "In 18 hours..." "What do you mean Arslacone gave an order which Gorkith fearfully complied with?" asked Jomara. "What was the order?" "All will be clear," smiled Hallgard. "I have to choose what to reveal and what to conceal. Such is the way of the tale-teller." "In 18 hours, Gorkith had 53 suits of bone mail," said Hallgard, continuing, not really minding the interruption, "prepared for the slaves. Without prompting, he ordered the slaves to practice using the armor, and even allowed them more training time than their predecessors. They not only learned how to move and stop quickly in bone mold, but how to adjust their peripheral vision to see a blow before it came, and to sway to dodge, and where the sturdiest reinforcement points on the arm were, the center of the chest and the abdomen, and how to position themselves to take blows there against their natural instincts. The slaves even had time for a mock battle before being sent out among the cannibals. The slaves handled themselves admirably. Very few, just 15 slaves, were killed and eaten outright. Only 10 were killed and eaten when they reached the river. That was when things did not go according to Arslacone's plans. 21 slaves with jars of water took off for the hills. Only 8 returned to the castle, largely because they were blocked by the cannibal Nords. It was a larger percentage than he had anticipated surviving, but Arslakoan felt righteous indignation at the paucity of loyalty. "Are you absolutely certain you wouldn't rather flee?" he hollered from the battlements. Finally, he allowed the survivors in. 3 had been killed waiting for the gate to open. 2 more died almost upon stepping into the courtyard. 1 was delirious, walking around in circles, laughing and dancing before suddenly collapsing. That meant 5 jars of water for 4 people, the 2 surviving slaves, Arslakoan and Gorkith. As the lord of the manor, Arslakoan took the extra jar, but he was democratic with the others. "You're quite correct," frowned Garaz. "This story is getting more and more appalling." "Just wait," smiled Hallgard. The next morning, Hallgard continued, Arslakoan awoke to a perfectly still and quiet stronghold. There was no murmuring in the corridors, no sound of hard labor in the courtyard. He dressed and surveyed the scene. It appeared that the fortress was utterly deserted. Arslakoan walked down to the armorer's quarters, but the door was locked. "Open up," said Arslakoan patiently. "We need to speak. 30 out of 54 slaves successfully made it to the river and gathered water. Admittedly, some then fled, and a couple didn't survive because I needed to correct their fickleness, but mathematically that's a 55% survival rate. If you and I and the 2 remaining slaves made the next run to the river, we too should survive." "Zillion and Gello left last night with their armor," cried Gorkleth through the door. "Who are Zillion and Gello?" "The 2 remaining slaves. They don't remain anymore." "Well, that's vexing," said Arslakoan. "Still, we must continue on. Mathematically..." "I heard something last night," whispered Gorkleth in a funny voice. "Like footsteps, only different, and they were moving through the walls. And there were voices, too. They sounded strange, like they couldn't move their jaws very well, but I knew one." Arslakoan sighed, humoring his poor armorer. "And who was it?" "Ponik." "And who is Ponik?" "One of the slaves that died when the Nords poisoned our water. One of the many, many slaves that died and we made use of. He was always a nice, uncomplaining fellow. That's why I noticed his voice above all the others," Gorkleth began to sob. "I understood what he was saying." "Which was what?" asked Arslakoan with a sigh. "Give me back my bones," Gorkleth's voice shrieked. There was silence for a moment, and then more hysterical sobbing. "I saw that coming," laughed Jomara. "There was nothing more to be done with the armorer for the time being," said Hallgard, a trifle annoyed at the regular interruptions. So Arslakoan stripped one of the dead slaves of his suit of bone mold and put it on. He practiced in the courtyard, impressing himself with his natural comfortability with medium-weight armor. For hours, he boxed, feinted, dodged, sprinted, skipped, jumped, and generally cavorted about. When he felt tired, he retired to the shade and took a nap. The sound of the king's trumpet woke him with a start. Night had fallen, and for a moment he thought he had been dreaming. Then the alarum sounded again, far in the distance but clear. Arslakoan leapt to his feet and ran to the ramparts. Several miles away, he could see the emissaries and their vast and well-armed escort approach. They were there early. The cannibal Nords below looked at one another with consternation. Savages they might be, but they knew when a superior force was approaching. Arslakoan joyously dashed down the stairs to Gorkleth's chamber. The door was still locked. He beat on it, cajoling, demanding, threatening. Finally, he found a key, one of the few scraps of metal that had not been smelted days before. Gorkleth appeared to be sleeping, but as Arslakoan approached, he noticed that the armorer's mouth and eyes were wide open and his arms were folded unnaturally behind his back. On closer inspection, the armorer was obviously dead. What was more, his face and whole body were sunken like an empty pig's bladder. Something moved through the walls, like a footfall, only squishy. Arslakoan expertly and gracefully turned to face it, completely in balance. At first, it seemed like nothing more than a bubble expanding through one of the cracks in the stone. As more of the flesh-colored, gelatinous matter emerged, it more clearly resembled part of a face. A flaccid, almost shapeless face with a low brow and a slack, toothless jaw. The rest of the body oozed out of the crack, a soft bag of muscle and blood. Behind Arslakoan and to the side, there was more movement, more slaves welling up through the cracks in the stone. They were all around him, reaching out. "Give us," moaned Ponik, his tongue rolling about his hanging jaw. "Give us back our bones." Arslakoan began to rip off his bone mold, throwing it to the floor. 100 figures, more, pooled into the small chamber. "That's not enough." The cannibals had cleared away by the time the king's emissaries arrived at Arslakoan's gates. They had not been looking forward to this visit. It was best, they thought philosophically, to begin with the worst of the king's henchmen, so to end their trip well. They sounded the alarum once again, but the gates did not open. There was no sound from Arslakone's stronghold. It took a few hours to gain access. If the emissaries had not brought a professional acrobat with them for entertainment, it might have taken longer. The place seemed to be abandoned. They searched every room, until finally they came to the armorer's. There they found the master of the manor folded neatly, legs behind his head, arms behind the legs, like a fine gown, not a bone in his body. "The first part of your story was complete nonsense," cried Jomara, "but now it doesn't hold true on any level. How could bone mold be made again if the armorer who invented it died before he could tell anyone how he did it?" "I said that this was the first time it was created, not the first time people learned the craft." "And when did someone first teach someone else the craft?" asked Garaz. "That, my friends," replied Hallgard with a sinister smile, "is a tale for another night." Oh, there's Bone Part 2. And there is another new book, Confessions of a Dunmer Skooma Eater. Take it off the list and read it. All sorts of new books in this expansion. Nothing is more revolting to Dunmer feeling than the sorry spectacle of another Dunmer enslaved by that derivative moonsugar known as skooma, and nothing is less appetizing than listening to the pathetic tales of humiliation and degradation associated with a victim of this addictive drug. Why, then, do I force myself upon you with this extended and detailed account of my sins and sorrows? Because I hope that by telling my tale, the hope of redemption from this sorry state shall be more widely known, and because I hope that others who have also fallen into the sorry state of skooma addiction may therefore hear of my story, of how I fell into despair, and how I once again found myself and freed myself from my own self-imposed chains. Because it is widely known to all Khajiit who may be expected to know that there is no cure for addiction to skooma, that once a slave to skooma, always a slave to skooma. Because this is widely known, it is taken to be true. But it is not true, and I am living proof. There is no miracle cure, there is no potion to be taken, there is no magical incantation which frees you from the thrill of skooma running through your blood, but it is through the understanding of that thrill, and the acceptance of the lust within oneself for that thrill, and the casting aside of the shame that the thrill-seeker feels when he cannot set aside what becomes in the end his only comfort and pleasure. It is through this knowledge and understanding that the victim comes to the place where choices may be made, where despair and hope may be separated. In short, only knowledge and acceptance can deliver into the slave's hands the key that opens his shackles and sets him free. Almost sounds like a recovery program for a real-world drug. Anyway, that's another book that actually shows up in Morrowind and is quest-related in that game. It's just lore here in the Dragonborn expansion. The Axeman, another new book. An axe skill book in its appearance in Morrowind, but just a lore book here. The Axeman, a surprising way to become proficient with an axe. Of all the members of the Morag Tong I've spoken with, none disturbed me as much as Minas Torek, a quiet and reserved man who never drank, never visited a brothel, or even uttered a curse. He was famous for his ability to make people disappear. Once a person was targeted by the Brotherhood and Torek was sent to them, they would simply cease to be. I asked him what his weapon of choice was and was equally startled by his answer. "I only likes to use axes," he said in his typical quiet voice. The image of this silent, dour fellow attacking anyone with a weapon as inherently bloody and violent as an axe so frightened and intrigued me that I questioned him about it further. This is an inherently dangerous activity, for assassins are not typically keen to give out their stories. Torek did not mind the questions, though it took some time to get the full story out of him, as naturally shy and reserved as he was. It seemed that Torek had been orphaned at a very young age and sent to live with his uncle, a salt rice plantation owner in Sheogorod in northern Vardenfell. The man promised to show his nephew the business and eventually make him a partner when he was old enough. In the meantime, the boy was put to work as his uncle's house servant. It was a grueling life, as the old man was very particular about how things should be done. The boy was first required to give all the floors in the house a thorough scouring, from the attic to the cellar. Whenever the floor was not cleaned to the uncle's satisfaction, which was frequent, Torek was thrashed and forced to begin again. The boy's second duty was to ring the bell that would bring the laborers into the house. This was done at least 4 times a day, once for each meal, but if his uncle had any news or additional instructions for the laborers, which he frequently did, the bell might need to be sounded 12 times or more. It was a huge iron bell in the tower, and the boy quickly discovered that he had to throw his entire body into the motion of pulling the chain in order to have it sound loud enough to bring everyone in from the field. If he was tired and did not pull the back-breaking chain hard enough, his uncle was soon at his side to beat him until he rang the bell loud and clear. Torek's third task was dusting all the shelves in his uncle's vast library. As deep and old as the shelves were, he was required to work with a long, heavy duster on a rod. The only way that he could reach to the back of the shelves was to hold the duster at his shoulder and then swing it out in a sweeping motion. Again, if the uncle saw any dust left over or felt that the boy was not working as hard as he ought to, the punishment was swift and severe. After several years, Minas Torek grew into a young man, but his job responsibilities were not increased. His uncle promised to teach him the business once Torek had demonstrated his mastery of his servile assignments. Divorced from any knowledge of any work other than his own, Torek never knew how badly in debt his uncle was and how poorly the farm's yield was. In his 18th year, Torek was called into the cellar by his uncle. He thought that he had not done a good enough job scouring the floor down there, and was frightened of the beating to come. What he found, however, was his uncle packing his goods into crates. "I'm leaving Morrowind," he explained. "The business has gone sour, so I thought I'd try my luck running a caravan in Skyrim. I understand there's good money to be made trading fake Dwemer artifacts to the Nords and Cyrodiils. I wish I could take you with me, my lad, but there won't be much need for scouring, bell-pulling, and dusting where I'm going." "But, uncle," said Torek, "I can't read, I knows nothing of the business you promised to teach me. What wills I do's on my own?" "I'm certain you can find a job in some domestic capacity," shrugged the uncle. "I've done my best with you." Torek had never stood up to his uncle before, and felt no anger, only a sort of coldness that gripped his heart. Among his uncle's possessions being packed away was an old heavy iron axe, allegedly of Dwemer manufacture. He picked it up in his hands and was surprised to find that it was not much heavier than his dusting rod. In fact, it felt very comfortable as he pulled it over his shoulder and swung it out as he had done so many times before. In this instance, however, he swung it into his uncle's right arm. The old man screamed with pain and rage, but for some reason Torek didn't feel frightened anymore. He propped the axe against his other shoulder and swung it out again. It cut a swath across the old man's chest and he fell to the floor. Torek hesitated before lifting the axe above his head. It was another natural position for him, like he was ringing a bell. Over and over again he swung down as if he was calling the laborers in from the field, except that this time there was no sound except for a wet thump, and no laborers came in from the field. Of course, his uncle had sent them away hours before. After a time, there was nothing left of his uncle that couldn't be washed down the cellar drain. The process of cleaning up came easily to Torek as well. Blood scrubbed up much quicker than the usual grime and salt rice flour that littered the cellar floor. It was well known that Torek's uncle was planning to leave Morrowind, so his disappearance provoked no suspicion. The house and all the belongings were sold to the debt collectors, but Torek took the axe. It seemed that his uncle had given him some worthwhile business skills after all. Oh, there you go. We'll worry about those later. Those East Empire Company strong boxes all relate to a particular quest we can get here in Ravenrock. For my part, I'm just going to cross back over into the Bulwark Jail. Here's the prisoner belongings chest. This place is interesting. The escape route is a little bit more complicated than what we're used to. I'll show you what I mean. So, we can pick up the, or we can pick the lock into the cell, or into this room, rather. There are more copies of Bone. We've already read that. So, here in what I must say is a very cozy little jail cell, there's a novice-locked grate, which, naturally, we can spring. To find an escape route, takes us down into a tunnel. Oh, and look at that architecture. That's right, escaping the Ravenrock Jail actually sends you into a miniature dungeon. A Nordic barrow called Cold Cinder Cave. So here we are inside Cold Cinder Cave, and we're going to encounter some of the new Dragonborn expansion enemies in here. Search these skellies first. Make sure I have Aura Whisper on so I don't miss anything. Okay, I see him. We're good. Now this is interesting and also unique, architecture-wise. So those are Netch, which you may, of course, recognize from Morrowind. And this is something new, I think. Oh no, that's just a skeever. Yes, there are Netch in here. They come in various sizes, although they've, they got rid of the different skin types. They all look the same now. And they've also inverted. Bull Netch are now the strongest. Betties are in the middle, and obviously calves are the weakest. Nonetheless, let's head over here. We need 5 Netch jelly for a quest later on. So I'll hold on to the first 5 I find. That's 2. I need 3 more. Netch leather is not useful in this game the way it was before. There's another Netch jelly. Only need 2 more. And we can keep on moving through this funky-looking architecture. Maybe you can't see Ash Spawn with Aura Whisper. You must not be able to, or we'd be seeing him by now. Well, you'll see. So there's the exit, which will actually take us up onto a cliff just outside Ravenrock. But let's explore this little teeny bit of dungeon down here first. We got Scathecraw, which we've seen before. Really have anything new over here. You'll notice there is a tunnel over here. Let's see what's in here. Let me check again. Oh, maybe it will show us Ash Spawn. Or maybe those are Netch. I can't quite tell. Oh good, it will show us Ash Spawn. So he's inside the ground, inside that pile of ash. Here is an Ash Spawn, which we haven't seen before. They're brand new enemies. They don't exist in Morrowind either. Not as such. So when you search them, you can get a new ingredient called Spawn Ash. I'll just eat one to learn all 4 effects, which are Ravage Stamina, Resist Fire, Fortify Enchanting, and Ravage Magicka. And that Spawn Ash is off the list. Neat. Oh, there's very little left on this list now. How exciting. Anyway, I'll run without sneaking to make sure I aggro the other two. Ash Spawn Immolator. So they're leveled, just like most other critters. And just like that, we have cleared Cold Cinder Cave. So even though it's not a discoverable location... Oh wait, yes it is. Just kidding. Even though we haven't discovered it yet, we have now cleared Cold Cinder Cave, which is kind of fun. See, there it is, cleared with the death of that immolator. Now we can get something else that we actually need out of here. This Heartstone deposit. You can only get one, and we only need one for the gear checklist. Oh, maybe you can get three. Or maybe you can only get two. Nope, you can get three. But I only need one Heartstone, so I'm only going to bother carrying one around. So now Heartstone is off the gear list. 10 Stalrim, 50 Reekling Spears, and 2 Netch Jelly, and I'll have everything I need to collect. Here's the boss chest for Cold Cinder Cave. Nothing too exciting inside, but you can still see it there if you're interested. And obviously, we've got Heartstone deposits in here if we wind up needing them. They exist all over the southern part of Solstheim. There's some thematic mixing with Solstheim. The southern half has been covered in ash by the constant eruptions of Red Mountain, and so it's sort of an ash waste, much like Vardenfell was in Morrowind. The northern half of Solstheim is still relatively unaltered from its appearance in Blood Moon. It's the same icy, icy, inhospitable place it was in the Blood Moon expansion. Now, I don't think that's Cold Cinder Cave. No, I'm pretty sure that's actually something else entirely. Yeah, that's Kolbjorn Barrows. I was right, actually. I have it on my list, but it shouldn't be there. You can't discover Cold Cinder Cave. You can only clear it, which, of course, we have now done. Well, let me look around up here where we emerged. Just to make sure there's no stuff I need to look for, focus on tracking down. You can see we're up here above the exit from the town. Looks like we're good. Let's kind of... I was going to say let's stay up top, but I'm more or less feeling done now, so let's move on. So here is the Caerellius house, which I'll go ahead and spring open. I think it's going to be empty to start out with. We've read both of those. Yes, the two people who actually live here start out inside the Ravenrock mine. So we're free to look around the house. What we're going to find are the 3-volume History of Ravenrock. So let's cut through that. 1, 2, 3. The History of Ravenrock, Volume 1 by Lyran Teleno. And that one's off the list. Forward. Ravenrock is one of the more interesting colonies of Morrowind of the last 2 centuries. So much has happened to this tiny town in such a short amount of time, and so many lives have been affected by it, I felt it necessary to describe its rich history within these volumes. During my research, I lived in Ravenrock for almost 3 years, and I got to know many of my fellow Dunmer who call Ravenrock their home. I hope that my readers will appreciate the amount of fortitude and perseverance that it must take to endure life in such an inhospitable and untamed land. Ravenrock was founded in 3E427 by the East Empire Company in response to the discovery of a rich ebony mine on the southern edge of the island of Solstheim. The construction of the town took several months, and the mine immediately started yielding ebony ore that the miners shipped to Windhelm in Skyrim. By 3E432, the town was home to over 30 people, all of whom depended on the mine for their livelihood. At this time, Ravenrock was almost exclusively inhabited by Imperials and a few Nords who were drawn to the mine's wealth. When the Oblivion Crisis arose in 3E433, Ravenrock remained largely untouched by Mehrunes Dagon's forces, and work continued as usual. The bulk of the Imperial Guard that was stationed in Ravenrock was recalled to Cyrodiil to fight the invading forces, but a few soldiers remained behind in order to protect the Ebony Mine from bandits. It's uncertain whether any Oblivion Gates ever opened on Solstheim, as there appears to be no record of such an event ever occurring there. In the first year of the Fourth Era, after the destruction of Aldrun, many of the Dunmer Great Houses sent out small groups of their own to seek places to re-establish themselves. House Redoran's group was led by Brara Morvane, who immediately struck out for Solstheim. After some quick negotiations with the East Empire Company, and some speculate quite a bit of coin changing hands, Brara's group was allowed to settle in Ravenrock, where they quickly became a part of the mining colony's way of life. The Dunmer proved to be both hard-working and reliable when it came to working in the mines, impressing the East Empire Company and solidifying their relationship. All was going quite well until that fateful day at 4E5 when the Red Mountain suddenly erupted, sending a massive blast across the Sea of Ghosts that struck Solstheim with its full fury. Ravenrock was heavily damaged by this wave of force, which toppled several of its stone structures and obliterated many of the wooden ones. Ironically, the mine once again proved to be the town's saving grace, as most of the population of Ravenrock was working underground at the time and was completely shielded from the blast. This event wasn't without cost, however. Ravenrock was heavily dependent on nearby Fort Frostmoth for its defense, but the eruption had almost completely wiped it from the face of Solstheim. The few soldiers that survived took residence in Ravenrock itself and attempted to set up a makeshift garrison there, but these scant few were hardly a match for potential threats to their town. With the East Empire Company's permission, Brara brought in some of House Redoran's elite Redoran Guard to fill the void. The Guard proved to be an ideal replacement for the fallen Imperial soldiers and have been guarding the town ever since. Volume 2. Take it off the list and read it. The History of Ravenrock, Volume 2, by Lyran Teleno. Foreword. Ravenrock is one of the more interesting colonies of Morrowind of the last two centuries. So much has happened to this tidy town in such a short amount of time, and so many lives have been affected by it, I felt it necessary to describe its rich history within these volumes. During my research, I lived in Ravenrock for almost 3 years, and I got to know many of my fellow Dunmer who call Ravenrock their home. I hope that my readers will appreciate the amount of fortitude and perseverance that it must take to endure life in such an inhospitable and untamed land. After a few years, the relentless ash storms from the ever-erupting Red Mountain had transformed Solstheim's southern reaches into pure ash wastes reminiscent of those present on Vardenfell itself. The storms would leave behind deep dunes of ash that made life exceedingly difficult in Ravenrock. In order to protect the town from these drifts, Brara Morvane proposed that the East Empire Company construct a large wall of her own design to protect the east end of the town. The company quickly agreed and provided the necessary funds. After almost a year, the construction was complete, and the huge edifice was named the Bulwark. The wall proved to be extremely effective and allowed work to continue unabated in the mines. In 4E16, when Solstheim was passed into the hands of the Dunmer people, the East Empire Company was forced to relinquish Ravenrock's control to House Redoran. The council quickly named Brara Morvane as counselor of their new town, and allowed her to rule Solstheim as she saw fit. As a result of this changing of the guard, almost the entire Imperial population left Ravenrock and returned to Cyrodiil. Brara continued to welcome the Dunmer that elected to settle on Solstheim. Some chose to stay in Ravenrock to work in the mines, and others took to more familiar territory and began a nomadic lifestyle in the Ash Wastes. The next few decades were the golden years for Ravenrock. Brara Morvane was keeping the peace, the mines were still producing large quantities of ebony, and the Dunmer that lived on the island were happy. After almost 50 years of prosperity, in 4E65, Brara Morvane finally succumbed to old age and passed away. She was interred in the family's ancestral tomb, and her son, Laryl Morvane, took her place. The people who had lived in Ravenrock during Brara's time as counselor were pleased to discover that Laryl shared his mother's notion of rulership. His mother's notions of rulership. He was fair and compassionate, which kept the people on the island quite happy for many decades. And finally, we have History of Ravenrock, Volume 3, to be read and removed from the list. The History of Ravenrock, Volume 3, by Lyran Teleno. Foreword. Raven Rock is one of the more interesting colonies of Morrowind of the last two centuries. So much has happened to this tiny town in such a short amount of time, and so many lives have been affected by it, I felt it necessary to describe its rich history within these volumes. During my research, I lived in Raven Rock for almost 3 years, and I got to know many of my fellow Dunmer who call Raven Rock their home. I hope that my readers will appreciate the amount of fortitude and perseverance that it must take to endure life in such an inhospitable and untamed land. All was going well in Raven Rock until 4E95, when an attempt on Laryl's life was made without warning. Fortunately, the attack was unsuccessful thanks to the prowess of the Redoran Guard. Under questioning by Captain Moden Veleth, the assassin was revealed to be Vilur Ulan of House Lalu. House Lalu had been at odds with House Redoran for years following their removal from the Council of Great Houses. The Lalu believed that House Redoran was instrumental in this reorganization, and have held a grudge ever since. Their attempt on Laryl's life was meant to send a message to the Council that House Redoran was not as mighty as they purported to be, and that they were truly vulnerable and weak. The Redoran Guard investigated further and discovered that Vilur had been organizing a coup in Raven Rock in an attempt to fully wrest control of the island from Laryl's grasp. Vilur and his conspirators were executed and the coup was quelled. Several recent events have served to solidify the Dunmer people's respect for Laryl Morvane. In 4E130, the bulwark began to show its age and threatened to crumble. The counselor elected to use the bulk of his personal fortune to have it repaired. In 4E150, a small force of Argonians landed on Solstheim with the intent of wreaking havoc on the island, and Counselor Morvane led the charge against them personally. And in 4E175, when the Ebony Mine finally began to dry up, 4E170, when the Ebony Mine finally began to dry up, he drained the remainder of his coffers, keeping the people fed. By 4E181, the mine's ebony veins were completely exhausted. Laryl ordered the mine to be shut down, and Raven Rock turned to hunting and fishing for its trade. A few Dunmer families departed Solstheim and returned to the mainland, but most stayed behind. At present, Laryl Morvane is still the ruler of Raven Rock. The Redoran Guard continues to maintain order within the town and the surrounding area, keeping Raven Rock's residents safe and in line. If even so much as a rumor of dissent reaches Laryl's ears, he has it quashed immediately. He's well aware that there may be a few Lalu loyalists still present among her population that would like to see him dead. The future may appear bleak for Raven Rock, but the spirit of its inhabitants will never be broken. Cool. Another East Empire strongbox, which I'll just briefly leave alone until we get the relevant quest. Let's head upstairs. Some gold. Well, why not, right? And a chest. Sure. More books. Good. Dunmer of Skyrim. Okay. Oh, the True Noble's Code. That one's new. Take that off the list and read it. The True Noble's Code by Serio Athan Serethi. The honorable warriors of the Great House Redoran are the hereditary defenders of the Morrowind. To be a noble of House Redoran is more than being a great warrior. One must follow the triune virtues of duty, gravity, and piety. A Redoran's duty is first to the Tribunal Temple, second to the Great House Redoran, and third to one's family and clan. In the Battle of Red Mountain, warriors of House Redoran died bravely for their duty to the Tribunal. By defending House Redoran from the schemes of Telvanni wizards and the lies of untrustworthy Lalu, the True Noble shows duty to House Redoran. Following the Temple's guidelines of mercy and generosity show duty to one's family and clan. A Redoran noble must know the virtue of gravity. It is not the Redoran way to laugh at serious matters, for it shows disrespect. It is not the Redoran way to spread rumors, for they fester and breed dissension. A Redoran must show piety to the Aedra and Daedra, our creators and ancestors, for without the divine we would not have the chance to serve, and without divine law we would not know right from wrong, and without giving thanks for these things we would forget our place and our purpose. Great House Redoran praises all the skills of war. Not because we believe war is good or honorable in its own right, but because this knowledge is necessary to perform one's duty. House Redoran's warrior fight with a long blade and a shield, or with a spear. A noble of House Redoran must also learn to use a bow, and must be athletic enough for the long marches to battle. A Redoran wears heavy or medium armor, depending on rank and strategy. A noble of House Redoran is expected to know how to repair and maintain his own armor. Those who are born to House Redoran have been taught their skill and virtues by kin and clan. Those who seek to enter House Redoran as retainers must satisfy an examiner in the Redoran Council Hall that their skills are suitable for service to House Redoran. Whether born to the blood of House Redoran or adopted into service of House Redoran by oath, those who seek to advance in the ranks of House Redoran must demonstrate their virtues by service and obedience. And only when one has mastered all the skills and virtues can one truly call himself a noble of the great House Redoran. So you may know in Morrowind there are books that describe each faction and its favored skills and attributes. That is actually the book from Morrowind about the House Redoran faction, just in case you were curious. Let's check out the Ulan Ancestral Tomb, just because it's right here. And check the center tomb. I don't think there's anything in here at the outset. The Temple Ancestral Tomb requires key. Fair enough. This all looks remarkably like the Ancestral Tombs from Morrowind, although it doesn't have the whispering ghost effect that game had. Which is unfortunate, because that was a cool effect. Anyway, this one looks empty. Fair enough. Alright, let's head on out. Alright, we'll just keep working our way over. We'll head up these steps and enter the actual temple now. Now there are a couple of people to actually speak to in here. There's Elder Othraloth, who doesn't have anything I need.
Are below and danger lurks beyond the light. I am confident that they will never abandon us again. Are you here to pray, or perhaps pay your respects at our ancestral tomb? I am Othraloth, Elder of the Reclamations and Keeper of this temple. The reclamations herald the dawn of a new age and the downfall of the false tribunal. If you're in need of anything material, Attendant Hilaru can assist you. Syrah?
What are the ancestral tombs?
They're where we inter our dead. They are sacred places, meant to honor their passing. Sadly, we've been unable to use the ancestral tomb beneath the temple as of late, and have resorted to other locations to scatter the remains.
Why can't you use the tomb?
Those foul vermin, the abominations we call Ashspawn, have risen from the ashes of our own ancestors. They're befouling the memories of our forefathers by defiling their remains.
I'll cleanse the tomb for you.
Thank you, Wanderer. That would be most kind. Here, this key should open the door to the tomb.
Ravenrock tomb key added. Clear the temple's tomb of Ashspawn. Do you know someone called Mirak?
Sounds like something from a dream, and yet it might be more strange.
What sort of dream?
I remember a temple on Solstheim. And working to build something. It was not a pleasant dream.
What exactly are the reclamations?
The reclamations are the true tribunal, the Daedra that consecrate the Dunmer people, Azura, Methala, and Boethia. We call them the true tribunal because they have reclaimed their place in our false tribunal that came before.
The false tribunal?
Sotha Sil, Amalexia, and Vivek represent what was beings who won the Dunmer people's hearts with their actions, but blinded them just the same. They were aberrations, false prophets. They used their status as heroes to shield the true tribunal from our minds. But now that they've been destroyed, the light can finally shine upon the House of Reclamations.
How do the Dunmer bury their dead?
The Dunmer race doesn't bury their dead, or leave them to rot inside a stone sarcophagus. When a Dunmer passes, his body is given to fire, so he might return to the ash from whence he came. The Dunmer don't believe that death is the end. We believe that it's the beginning.
Fair enough.
Be cautious, friend. The ash spawn are soulless beings with no regard for compassion.
Sure. Alright, let's stick with this floor for now. And let's note that we do have cleared the temple's tomb of ash spawn, and we've advanced Dragonborn. We completed search for information about Mirak. We completed investigate the shrine. The people of Ravenrock know the name Mirak, saying that he has a temple near the center of the island. I should seek him out and find out why people have attacked me on his behalf. Reach the temple of Mirak. There you go. Let's look around in here. I'd like to find Attendant Lervu, but I think I heard him leave. So, here's a shrine of Boethia. So anyway, a lot of follow-up lore for people who were big fans of Morrowind and wonder what the fallout might have been. What does the Blessing of Boethia give you, I wonder? Ah, fortify one-handed, 10%. Okay, that's in keeping with what we know, I suppose. I don't want to steal the Scathecraw, just want the coins. How about Mephala? What's that one do? Fortify Barter? Seriously? That's what Mephala does? Alright, that's out of character. That doesn't make any sense. Let's see about the others. I guess this one will be Azura. What's hers? What do we get from the Shrine of Azura? Ten percent magic resist. It seems a little silly just to rehash blessings available elsewhere. And there's a History of Ravenrock, Volume 1. Let's poke around the rest of the temple. Five Far Stars is a new book, so let's read it right quick and then take it off our list. The Five Far Stars. This is a volume of verse collected from wise women of the Urshilaku Ashlanders. It consists of verses composed by Ashlander warriors, champions, and Ashcans, committed to memory by the wise women and transmitted down the generations. May I Shrink to Dust is attributed to the long-dead poet and warrior Zershishi Musmanul. Rise from darkness, Red Mountain. Spread your dark clouds in green vapors. Birth earthquakes, shatter stones, feed the winds with fire, flay the tents of the tribes from the land. Feed the burned earth with our souls, yet never shall you have your rule over me. Never shall I tremble or flinch from your power. Never shall I yield my home and hearth, and from my tears shall spring forth the flowers of grassland springs. Bone Part 1 and 2. This is not an East Empire strongbox. Let's read The Reclamations. A book that does not appear in Morrowind is brand new for the Dragonborn expansion. The Reclamations, The Fall of the Tribunal and the Rise of the New Temple by Thara of Rihad. The destruction of Vivek City and the subsequent eruption of Red Mountain in 4E5 was not just a crisis in terms of the physical destruction it caused. It also cut deeply into the ancient religious beliefs of the Dunmer. The fall of the Ministry of Truth was the last straw in the tottering support for the temple's worship of Almalexia, Sothisil, and Vivek. With all three of the tribunes now widely believed dead or disappeared, what had been a simmering schism within the ranks of the temple priesthood burst into the open. While outsiders may never know the full tale of this internal struggle, when the smoke cleared a few years later, the former dissident priests were in full control of the temple hierarchy, with tribunal loyalists either purged or recanted. The so-called new temple now declared the worship of the tribunes a result of misguided teaching, blaming the mistakes on the former tribunal. The temple now taught that the Daedra venerated by the Ashlander tribes, Azura, Mafala, and Boethia, were the true way and should be revered by the Dunmer people. Fittingly, the Daedra were named the Reclamations, as if they were reclaiming their status from the Tribunal. In an elegant compromise, no doubt intended to reconcile the large majority of the Temple priesthood, who were neither dissidents nor fanatic Tribunal loyalists, Almalexia, Sothisil, and Vivek were relegated to the status of saints, a traditional way to venerate the most honored Dunmer ancestors. This apparently satisfied enough of the existing priesthood that the new temple was able to maintain at least a semblance of outward continuity. The rise of the new temple almost completely vindicated the previously persecuted Ashlanders, who had continued to worship the three Daedra throughout the Tribunal's rule. The Ashlanders are now lauded as the keepers of the old ways and having true vision. It is now quite common for many of the Dunmer people to make the arduous pilgrimages into the Ash Wastes to seek the counsel of the Wise Women. These women have supposedly opened the eyes of those who they claim were blinded by the Tribunal, and directly connect the eruption of the Red Mountain and the Argonian invasion to the anger of the Three Daedra. House Indoril, whose fortunes were so entwined with the Tribunal Temple, suffered greatly from its fall. While House Indoril still technically exists, the priesthood of the Temple are now considered one and the same with House Indoril. Those who become priests are now considered to have joined Indoril. The political power of the Indoril has thus passed entirely into the hands of the Temple, although members of the old House Indoril are still overrepresented in the priesthood. The rise of the new Temple has a number of interesting parallels with the rise of House Redoran. Each filled the vacuum of power resulting from the crisis of the Red Year. How durable these new arrangements will prove, religious and political, remains to be seen. The span of two centuries is quite brief in the long history of the ancient Dunmer people. Well, that's true. We have in here The Doors of the Spirit. That is another new book. Let's take it off the list and read it. The Doors of the Spirit. The ancestors are among us. They are never farther away than the waiting door. The ancestors are not departed. The dead are not under the earth. Their spirits are in the restless wind, in the fire's voice, in the foot-smooth step. Pay heed to these things, and you will know your absent kin. Pay reverence through gift and prayer. Acquaint the ancestors with your affairs, with your comings and goings, with your blessings and trials. From the waiting door comes your protection. Heed the spirits who are the guardians of your hearth, teachers of wisdom, counselors of fortune, seers of fate. Each bone is a door through the wall of the world. Each bone is the road with wisdom and power the travelers. Each bone is the ghost fence that guards us from evil. Honor the ancestors upon your hearths, within your halls, in the community of your temples, in the solitude of your tombs. Guard your ancestors from beasts, from thieves, from profane priests and sorcerers. Let no creature steal your spirits, for the plundered hearth is diminished and the plundered tomb is shamed. Live in one world with your spirits. Honor the spirits within and without you. Do not grieve for the dead. Take shelter in their arms and pay heed to their words. Cool. Keep looking around. There's a new book, Deathbrand. Let's take it off the list and read it. Deathbrand, a pirate's tale. Hacknir Deathbrand was dying. For Garrick Windrime, ship's quartermaster, it was unthinkable. His grandfather had served under Hacknir nigh on 60 years before, and even then he was a legend among the pirates of the North. The King of Ghosts, they called him, as eternal and pitiless as the sea he sailed. To Garrick, who had seen him charge into battle, clad in armor of gleaming stalrim like the kings of old, his twin swords scything men like grass, Hacknir was practically a god. But none feared Hacknir more than his own crew. They knew his rages, his fits of madness, how he delighted in torture and murder for its own sake, and there were even darker rumors. Some said he fed upon the blood and souls of those he killed to extend his unnatural life. Some thought him a Daedra loosed upon the mortal world, and others said he owed his life and power, his armor and swords, to a pact with Dagon, Prince of Destruction. And the seal of that pact was the terrible wound that scarred his face, never to heal, the Deathbrand, which no man could look upon without flinching. All these things ran through Garrick's mind as he took his place on deck at the head of the crew, exchanging a curt nod with Thallon, the ship's helmsman and his chief rival. By sundown, he thought, one of them would be captain, the other would be dead. When Haknir finally emerged from his cabin, the crew fell silent. He looked frail, his voice raspy, but even so he had a presence about him. As he looked over his men, the most brutal murderers ever to ply the northern seas, not one could meet his gaze. At last he sighed. You wish to know who will be my successor and how my share of the treasure shall be divided. That was the question, but even so there were murmurs of protest. Haknir cut them off. All these years I have looked for one who is worthy to take my place or strong enough to take it from me. Not one of you even comes close, and so none of you shall have it. He extended his hand. In Dagon's name, I place a curse upon my armor and my swords, this ship and all it carries. Until the day when one of you can best me in combat, you shall have not a single coin. He looked up at them. Be grateful I have left you with your lives. Garrick and Thallon shared a single glance. Had anyone else said such a thing, there would have been mutiny. 100 treasure-mad pirates against one old man. But this was Haknir. The crew was silent. Haknir threw a map at Garrick's feet. Garrick, take a longboat and bury my armor in the places I have marked. Thallon, we sail to my tomb where you shall leave me with my gold. Then burn your ships and do as you will. I am your captain no more. And with that, he turned and stalked back to his quarters. At daybreak, Garrick took his leave and set out in a longboat with 3 of his men. They landed on a shoal to the north of Solstheim at the place Haknir had marked, made camp, and began to dig. But already greed stirred in Garrick's heart. Time and again he glanced at the iron-bound chest they had brought with them. The old man was gone, perhaps already dead, his orders foolish. That night, Garrick pried open the chest and drew out the helm within. The stall-rim shimmered in the moonlight. It was time. Time for a new king of ghosts to rise. He placed the helmet on his head, and he screamed. And it's said you can hear that screaming still on moonlit nights on a rocky shoal off the northern coast of Solstheim. Postscript. This story is one of the last in the Haknir saga, the tales surrounding the life and adventures of the legendary pirate king Haknir Deathbrand. How much of it is actually true, if indeed any of it is true, I leave to the reader's discretion. Artiste Draylan, House Rhetoran Scribe. Search for the treasure of Haknir Deathbrand. Well, of course. Duh. All right. And now we're ready to enter the Temple Ancestral Tomb with the key we received. And I am ready to end this video, because I have been going nearly 2 hours. This has been Let's Play Skyrim. We finished up on the mainland. Here we are, exploring again. The island of Solstheim, the Dunmer town of Ravenrock. Next time, we'll begin by clearing out the Temple Ancestral Tomb, then we'll continue to explore Ravenrock and collect quests. Until then, thank you so much for watching. If you enjoy my videos, please consider clicking an ad, liking, sharing, or subscribing, any or all of which really help me out. Regardless, please know that I really appreciate the time you spend watching, and hope you have a fantastic day.